think there are a lot of reasons constitution is not really the only inspiration. There, like, even ideologies, even ideas and other things also greatly motivate me, but constitution is one ready made.
Next question. Next. Yeah. Hey guys. You shoot, you made Najib disappear. We control the whole nation with fear. And let me make a one thing clear. Hinduist boys do as we please. My lynch map protected by police. I'm in New Delhi in my Mercedes. And my Mercedes full up by the disease. You know we eat the flattery of the vampire teeth. That fire burn rubber tire turn into fr- I was having this discussion with a friend last night itself, where we were discussing about how human beings have this tendency to follow religion because it gives them a code. It gives them a code of how to lead life and how to have interpersonal connections. And, you know, so, but, and I think the constitution also does that. Like, you know, you don't necessarily need religion perhaps because have you read so many. Have you read the judgment? Have you read the judgment of, I think, on Hindutva by the Supreme Court? I think it's a 96 or a 93 judgment, where the Supreme Court has stated that Hindutva is not a religion, it's a way of life.
It's a way of life.
Yeah, so when you look at these things, I believe religion gives you an identity, right? Religion gives you, okay, this is who I am. It gives you a purpose. And it gives it is a way of self-identification. Who am I? You know, like, for example, if you're an atheist, it will take you a while to realize that, okay, what are my beliefs, things like that. But if you are religious, your belief is, all right, I don't eat this, I don't do that, I go there, I go here. And I
think it's a very essential human aspiration to have some, to have the acknowledgement of having something as a super, as a higher power, to have something which mandates the way that we live. And religion gives us that tunnel, you know, and it's a very easily available tunnel because not a lot of questions go with it, because then it's just up to your faith, right? Yes. Because then it's a catch-22 situation, because you can't really question it and you don't want to question it, because if you question it, then it will make you question the very foundation of it. So then, like, what do you really do? And that's why, like, it's a much more nuanced debate.
Yeah.
It's important to acknowledge that.
Also, talking about human nature, I think that is the same logic that goes for people who follow leaders, Brian B., you know, who follow dictators. Like, why do you think millions of people fell for Hitler? Because you, natural human tendency is to look up to something.
Correct.
Yeah, and
absolutely.
Yeah.
It's not just human nature, but it's also something that leaders and individuals fend off. Like, because it's a trait of all leaders who are not just dictators, but, you know, leaders generally.
They have this charisma of
ensuring that people find the answer to their problems in what they say and what they stand for, right?
I think it's paternalism at its best, you know, because when you... Right. Okay, so because when you are born, you're told that you need to look up to your parents. My father is the best, my mother is the best. So it is already instilled that you look at a higher power. And first it's your parents, that it might be religion. I think it's fine till religion. The problem is when you go and idealize a leader. Because then it really becomes a problem. I think
it's not necessarily bad, like, because, you know, if that person is standing up for good ideas, for good values, then it's completely fine. Like, if you look up to individuals who are doing good for the world, and, you know, but still it's still important to not follow them blindly, no matter what the consequences are, be it good or for bad. It's important for all of us to have an independent understanding of how and where we stand on the topic, because it's important to acknowledge that, as you said, like, it's not that independent thinking is sometimes a hoax, because the climate and the society that we live in does not really give us that avenue of developing the thoughts for ourselves. It's very easy to just go with the flow and take up something as a status quo and then hold on to it for the rest of your lives without even questioning it. Because once you have that belief installed in you, any new information that goes inside your head your intuition and your biasness is going to play a great deal of load in how you take that in, and you know, how do you fix that with the rest of your issues. No, so also,
I will cut this next part, but just because we are on a discussion and it's a good discussion, and talking about Gandhi's trial, you know, I read, I was going to cut this part because Faltu mein controversy. Take a couple selfies with Instagram feeds, everybody say cheese, yeah, they will them. So if you think about it, it is very easy for these leaders to then lose it at the end. So where do you draw that line? Where do you draw that line where you idealize a leader and then what that leader does is not perfect? Because Hitler was an amazing man till he started saying Jews are bad. Like what he did for Germany, for example, Volkswagen, German superhighways, things like that. Yeah. So now next question.
It's the same thing with all communist dictators, because, you know, I was, yesterday was Lenin's birthday. So I was reading up a lot again about Lenin, about Stalin. So it's the same thing about, you know, what distinguishes Lenin and Stalin, and why Stalin became the dictator that he did was because of this. Because the idea that I have to protect individuals is something which flows both ways. Like if you tell people that I will protect you, they will listen to you. But then you yourself raise your mind on a higher moral ground, where then everything that you do is absolutely infallible and nobody can really question it. That's why for every debate on freedom of speech, it's important to recognize this, right? Like, because it's an essential part of ensuring how leaders work, how people follow, acknowledging these nuances of how our intuitions, how our biases come in the way of making a decision and what is really meant with that idea. Because speech is always free, but the consequences of speech may not be free.
Yeah.
Right? Like, can we take on these consequences of speech which may harm a society? Yeah. That's the point. That's the point. With hate speech, that's the same debate. That you have freedom of speech. Nobody will ever move away from the idea that there is no freedom of speech. But what if the consequences of your free speech lead to a material deterioration of the social fabric, then is it not ideal that we as a society come in and we stop that from happening?
No, but obviously last point, a very interesting discussion, but just the last point to make it, both if you see Lenin, Stalin had an anti-Leninist movement. Then after Stalin, Nikita Khrushchev, who was so loyal to him, then he had an anti-Stalinist movement. So that is what my point is, that all these dictators, there is a line. Have I told
don't
you about
all
my...
them dictators?
Sorry. have you
Lenin heard? Lenin was not a dictator. Lenin was not a dictator.
But
he died like 2 years. 2 years into his rule.
Vishal, you are a very big constitutional law enthusiast, right? So your passion towards law is just something else, and I think that's what makes you unique. That's why I wanted to have you on the show, that how while talking about law you forget everything what is happening around you in terms of how much money you make, what is happening. Like that is that passion that drives you. So I wanted to have this chunk of the segment on constitutional law. So you have been part of few exciting cases, and I want to talk about first of all Sabarimala judgment of it. So now, for viewers who don't know anything about Sabarimala was a judgment which allowed entry of women in a temple during certain times, right? Now, that judgment has went up for a review. So, as a normal citizen, that seems appalling to me, that a pro-right judgment went for review. So, can you explain me what is the logic behind that?
Right. Yeah. Just building on the background first. So, the decision was given, as you would know, by a 5-judge bench of the Supreme Court. And there were a few minorities. There was the minority of Justice Indu Malhotra as well, where she did not agree with the idea that the right to religion can encompass, can be encompassed by the argument of equality. Right? But there were a few doubts that were raised on that decision, and that's why it was sent for a review. And in the review, first of all, that's a debate which is still on as to whether they could have referred it to a larger bench during a review, because the limited scope of a review is just acknowledging whether the decision was right or was it wrong. Error apparent on the face of it. And that is that even the minority that was given by Justice Chandrachur and Justice Nariman, because they agreed that no matter what you feel about the veracity of what was said in the five-judge decision, none of that can be referred to a larger bench during a review stage. During a review stage, unless you note down what is wrong with the judgment, and that's the only thing that you can do. If you can note down what everything is wrong, you can set it aside basically. But what they have done is that it was sent for review. Now it was sent because there are two other decisions, way older decisions. One is Shirur Mutt, which is a 7-judge decision, and there is Dargah Committee, which is also 5-judge, which is a 5-judge decision. And both of them, there seems to be, like, it's not completely clear, but there seems to be certain differences as to how they have interpreted the right to religion, which as is existing in our constitution. So, what is the difference is that there is the questions that have been sent now to review, which are still pending before a 9-judge decision. It was supposed to start right after the Holi break, but because of this COVID lockdown, it's going to be taken up later on. But the questions that are involved are something which has never been debated in the Supreme Court with such great length. It's right to say that, in my opinion at least, that this was not even the avenue to do that, because as we said that, you know, how did it go from a 5-judge review to straight away to a 9-judge? There has to be some sort of judicial discipline in how the Supreme Court also follows procedure, right? Like a review's limited
mandate.
But
won't it be an appeal if it's going to a higher judgment?
How can it be an appeal? It can only go to a higher bench if another 5-judge bench would have felt that something is wrong with.
But ye to review bhi nahi ho gaya na fir. Ye to review bhi nahi hai. If you think about it,
in the review, all they could have done is said whether the judgment which was given originally was correct in the truest sense, or was there was which is apparent on the face of it.
And that has to be circulated among the judges of that judgment only. You can't refer it.
Right.
Yeah, because I have drafted the first draft of the review petition that challenged the Aadhaar judgment. And I actually know what are the powers. And that is appalling to me, that how did it go to a higher judgment?
Absolutely. And it's the same thing, because that's one critique of the Supreme Court that makes a lot of sense to me. And the more that I see its practice, I'm more convinced that it's true. That there is no judicial discipline in the Supreme Court. There are so many examples that we see on an everyday level of how procedure that is supposed to be followed by the Supreme Court with great deal of convention is flouted away without any explanation on the case of it.
Sometimes the way Justice Chandrachur cites his judgment, it feels like he wants it to be quoted. In the recent judgment with regard to whether Chief Justice of India is the member of is part of the office of Chief Justice of India is part of the Supreme Court. He gave recommendations for recruitment of judges, for appointment of judges, and they're very nicely at the end, absolutely not related, just because there was a point with regards to something he gave. And but I really admire him. Like he seems like a hope for.
Right. This is a very, very, this is a constant critique that is put against him, that, you know, he writes to the gallery. But, you know,
in the court,
his courts is one of the kindest to anybody, you know, that there, how he goes about running the court is so light, and it's because he will give lawyers all the time in the world, no matter how the case is, no matter how much time they want. He's very patient, always has a smile on his face. No matter what argument you want to make, he will listen, he will debate. There are so all of these things, apart from just the ideological developments, even about how he goes about running his court, is quite wonderful. Like, and yeah.
Good. Achha, batao mujhe baat karni
hai. And but specifically about writing in judges, like I remember he saying in court once about how he looks at judgment writing as a very essential part of being a judge. Yeah. And how, why he does that, like, you know, a lot of times, even in his dissents, even in his judgments, he lays down ideas for the future. And though at that point of time, it is very easy to say that there is no reason for you to say this, or you are just doing this to, you know,
yeah,
come across as a scholar, though you are, but just to a limited extent, you might be pandering to the intellectuals. But there is good reason to do that, I think, in my opinion. Because in a lot of cases, like, for example, we were recently working on this case with Haripriya ma'am. It was related to permanent commission of lady officers in the Indian Navy. Army and Air
Force. Yeah. No, there's a very famous case, no, where a transgender went. So, the exact line in the Navy is any man.
Right.
If you want to be part of the Navy, you have to be a man. Like, it's, and it has went up to the Supreme Court.
Absolutely. And so, but this one was limited to lady officers, and there, when we were researching on Article 14 claim, because we were trying to make the argument that there is discrimination in how the armed forces treat men officers and lady officers. Yeah. And though the argument on their behalf is always that we don't do that, of course, and all our regulations, our laws, and even how we conduct ourselves does not stink of any discrimination. But there was this one paragraph that Justice Chandrachud wrote in his in the 377 homosexuality case, where he spoke about how even facially neutral laws may have a discriminatory impact, like how certain laws which don't appear to cause any discrimination, but if you view them along with the existing social conditions or the preconditions with which you are assessing the situation, that will make it clear to you that there is a disproportionate impact on one community over the other. And the way he wrote that, it did not make a great deal of sense in the 377 judgment. But it's something that I realized that makes a lot of sense during our in our case. And we quoted it, and my boss, she was all very kind enough to point out to Justice Chandrachud that my junior here, he was really enthusiastic about this interview, and then he gave me a broad smile and I smiled back. So that was a good moment. So,
And I must tell you, as she herself says, she's half Indian. She spends a lot of time here. She knows, all about the law firms, and she knows everything. So. And I have questions from you guys also that you sent me. And yeah, so Claudia, tell us about yourself. What's your parent profile and things like that?
Well, now you've already shared I'm half Indian. I said that as a joke earlier. I'm just realizing I didn't even show you. I'm eating chili chocolate as we speak. So not only have I acquired the culture, but also the taste. So now that I'm locked in Austria, and I'm actually supposed to be in Mumbai at this very moment, spending a whole month between Delhi and Mumbai, so that got cancelled.